Right, so we have here people here, we've given some videos and have a check of the simulation.
Yeah, and then we've got some
images. We can share that across. So if you'd like to hang on for a bit, there's nobody can deck over there at the moment.
Right.
I'll pop over there and see what the simulation is. But I mean, just hang around and talk to Derek about simulators or whatever. Feel free. Or you can have a look at the Babbage machine. The Babbage machine will be demonstrated throughout the day.
Oh, well, right. Yes. So they've got it down at the moment.
No, they haven't.
Oh.
It's all back together again.
Is it? Ah, yes. They're still working on it.
Yes, but apparently, but yesterday afternoon, they had the whole thing working for the first time. And they
really?
All the carriers are working. I've been jumping on them to get it ready for today.
it must take quite a while. I mean, not refreshing the forces in action.
Yeah. Well, the engineers should be in fairly soon now, about 10:30 for you to get in here. So, and they'll be demonstrating what they're doing throughout the day.
Yes, we should call them coming.
In fact, if you're really interested, the engineers are in there now, and you might be able to talk to them.
That should be fascinating.
Dan, can you?
Last time I asked him, I thought it was wrong. I knew it. Thank you. about. Thank you. Dan, you won't be using this many times. decibel output, whether they're being any good or not. come very high up on the rating as a lively and energetic organisation by the simplest of measuring criteria. And looking back to what's happened since then, we've seen the exhibition, and I think you've all seen the exhibition downstairs on Babbage, the arrival of the second difference engine constructed in the gallery, or the latter stages of it constructed in the gallery in front of the public, and the enormous public response to that, quite extraordinary. Not accidental, one has to say, and the amount of stimulus and energy that has gone into generating that public interest and response to a very great extent the work of Doran and his colleagues is, I think, something which we can all take a lesson from, because Charles Babbage and those mechanisms are not everybody's cup of tea. They're not the sorts of things that people 2 or 3 years ago would have imagined would have great popular appeal. But it's quite clear from that exhibition and the continuing stream of people who came in during, for example, the latter stages of the construction, coming back to the museum again and again to see how it was getting on, the engine was getting on, and then to see the exhibition when the engine went on display as the centerpiece of the Babbage story, that presented properly and given the right sort of public relations and media coverage, not only in the specialist media, but in the popular press as well. And we know there is still more to come for Babbage and that project, that the public interest will be stimulated and people will come in and start to take notice. And to a great extent, I think it's the work of the Computer Conservation Society that has given us a lot of encouragement to start thinking beyond Babbage, the Pegasus achievement and the rather, I thought, threatening little simulation out there, which I assume will put the museum out of business if we transfer the whole of our collection. So we can junk them, close them here, have a small cabinet full of discs under the bed. Assuming we don't go quite as far as that, that again is an extraordinary example, not just of conservation, of the physical evidence in the form of the machine itself, but then of, so to speak, replication of everything it does as a sophisticated and highly interactive form of usable evidence. And it can, in fact, be repeated in many other areas of our collection. So what has been carried out there, Pegasus, has a much wider application, I think, than computing in terms of how we can record other types of equipment which we have in our collections. And that has led us to think about where we go from here. And quite clearly, the success of the Babbage project, and perhaps more particularly the Pegasus project, suggests that we ought to continue and to, in an incremental way, move from machine to machine, bring each up to a suitable display and a usable condition, and then to try and build those into evolving gallery. So in the early part of next year, the Babbage engine will move up into an area specially designed for it in the computer gallery. And what we hope then is, in an incremental manner over the following years, to take objects in which you have been involved from a conservation point of view and put them on display as well. So that seems to me to set out a program which should keep most of you going for a year or two at any rate. We do, not to be jocular, but we do value enormously the contribution that you have made already to our computing collections in terms of your knowledge and your expertise and the encouragement that you've given to our staff to put that collection into good order. And we anticipate and really hope that cooperation and support from will continue. And for our part, we will try and make sure that what you do gets public recognition by being transferred progressively into the public areas of the museum. The other aspect of this year, and it was fortuitous in a way that the Babbage exhibition should be on display on the ground floor, the top floor was the Japanese robotics exhibition. We only had it for 6 weeks. I hope at least some of you, perhaps most of you, saw it. A quite extraordinary demonstration of Japanese technology put on as part of the Japan Festival 1991. The shortest lived of the major Japan exhibitions, because of Visions of Japan, which I suggest you should also try and see if you can, across the road in the V&A, will be running until the end of the year. But in the case of the robotics exhibition, it could only really last for 6 weeks because of the enormous infrastructure costs of sustaining it here. The Japanese kept 42 engineers in London for the full 6 weeks. They wrecked the Tara Hotel, much better than Suntory, and if you're in the Tara Hotel, you get Irish whiskey as well as Scotch in more or less unlimited quantities. It was an absolutely outstanding success. We think they spent about £4 million on the exercise, at least that's what they've admitted to, and it might well have been more than that. And that too has been an eye-opener for us, because again, something which might appear to have some specialist appeal and certainly had a considerable following from the industrial and the robotic industry and British Robotic Association professional visitors was an enormous popular attraction, and 180,000 visitors came to that exhibition in the 6 weeks, which makes it, I think, probably the most populous exhibition that we've ever done here. So again, take something which might appear to be obscure and of perhaps rather narrow interest, and present it in an attractive and consumable manner, and promote it properly, and people will come. And not just come, but enjoy and gain some inspiration and enlightenment from it as well. That leads me, Tony, to the last, when I address these comments to you, particularly knowing of your Bletchley tendencies, to the proposal that there might be a Museum of Computing at Bletchley Park. Now, this is an interesting proposition. He said, cautious. It could be an exciting proposition. It could be the museum that denies every one of the principles I've just set out about being a popular and widely supported visitor attraction. But having said that, in terms of the proposals as they are now and what is being planned there, it is certainly something with which the Science Museum would wish to be associated. We would certainly want to give support to all of the analysis and feasibility work necessary to prove whether that museum is or is not a goer, because there is something there of real historical and archaeological interest. There is an opportunity to make much more of it with some of the equipment which was once used there, and there's a remarkable historical and social story too to be told in that place. What we would need to do, I think, is to reassure ourselves that it was capable of sustaining itself as a museum. And having been in museums for 30 years, I know that the worst people to set up museums are enthusiasts for the content of those museums, because they dismiss things like revenue budgets, visitors, and everything like that, as their focus is so wholeheartedly upon content. Now, content is one thing. Process is another. Potentially balancing the books at the end of the year is equally important. My hope is that we will carry out that series of analyses, and we'll very much want to do those with you and the Bletchley team to see if it is something which could come to fruition. And if it does, we would very much like to be a part of it, a supporter of it in some sense or another. Because I just do hold up that one caveat that we will need to be persuaded in very clear and vivid financial and operational terms that it stands some chance of surviving before we become a committed partner. A new museum has opened every 2 weeks in Britain since 1970. We can't carry on like that for very much longer before the whole country is one. We just charge them as they get off at Heathrow. Sadly, perhaps, and partly a reflection of the current economic circumstances, a newish museum is closing at the rate of about 1 a month. So we must go into this with our eyes open and with some very sound business sense behind us, as well as a professional and computer enthusiasm and expertise. So if I will finish there, Mr. Chairman, again to welcome you and to say, to repeat how very, very much we value everything that you are doing, not just in terms of the wider issues of computer conservation, but in supporting this museum and our work with these really quite extraordinary and outstanding collections. They really only have a real future if the sort of work that has been done with Pegasus can be repeated throughout the collection. Because we have now got, if only in that little disc outside, we've captured Pegasus for the future forever as a result of that work. And that is itself a quite remarkable and worthwhile achievement. Thank you.
Matheson, President of the BCS.
Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to keep you long, as Henry VIII said to several of the young ladies he engaged in wedlock. And if that remark points up some of the differences, the divide between the historians and sociologists of our society and the scientists and pioneers represented here tonight, I make no apology for it. Indeed, I like to link the two together, because I really do believe that when outside these frenetic and rather ill-focused times we live in, the measured evaluation of work in our society comes to be recorded, I'm quite sure in my own mind that the activities of the Computer Conservation Society and, sir, of the Science Museum will receive their well-deserved recognition. It's my pleasure, my humble pleasure, I have to say, in the presence of so many pioneers and so many distinguished past presidents of the BCS, to associate the society warmly with all that's going on in this quite magnificently focused joint venture. I don't think that even Tony could have believed a couple of years ago when this thing got underway that it would take off so far and so fast. It has been a significant achievement and one that's of worth not just for the people who are concerned today, but for the generations who are yet to come. And that's something that is mind-blowing, awe-inspiring, and humbling for anybody who contemplates the prospect. So the society is delighted to be associated with all that's involved in all of this. And indeed, I do hope that this joint venture will go from strength to strength. I would like to think that from the successes so far achieved, Tony, you can begin to think perhaps of a European dimension for all of this, no matter what happens at Maastricht next week. I hope that you can begin to focus on that. And if there is anything that the society can do through its network of European contacts and through CEPUS, then of course we'd be delighted to help. And finally, I do take the words of caution about Bletchley. Of course they need to be said. Funding is important, a business case is important, but by God beyond that, is that not an exciting concept? Is that not something that warms the cockles of your heart to think that such a significant site, right, with the history and the significance for this country that the Bletchley Huts represents should be preserved and put to good use and preserve for the future. I think that is just wonderful, and I applaud it with all my heart. Thank you very much. Tony, I hand
as they say, follow that. Well, thank you very much for those words of encouragement and the words of caution. I would, however, like to extend a welcome to Mrs. Ina Palmos, who is here as chairman of the Bletchley Archaeological and Historical Society, because it is actually due to her and her society's efforts that this whole Bletchley Park saga started. They are a small, local, archaeological and historical society. They're in Bletchley, and they were suddenly made aware that the park was about to be sold to a developer for demolition and redevelopment. They girded their loins and attacked this with some vigor, and it got English Heritage to come along and inspect the buildings. They then convinced English Heritage that the buildings, the huts, the remains should be listed, and English Heritage made an application to the DOE for a red spot listing on them. The Red Spot visiting application was made on historical grounds. The DOE turned it down on architectural grounds. We were never quite clear why that was, because the huts which were rapidly put up in 1941-42 were not exactly of architectural importance. But there's no denying that they are of historical importance. I got involved with this through Ina approaching me as a member of British Antiquities Society and as a member of the Conservation Society. And I saw the possibility of a combined museum of cryptography and computing in Bletchley Park. I didn't feel that either one was possibly viable on its own, but I thought the two together might actually tip the balance in both bringing in the funders and providing the research centre, which I feel is so essential to preserving the history of computing. I feel that the history has been neglected through no fault of the museum, which has limited resources and has multiple technologies to cover. But we have an opportunity at the moment to capture that history from all of you people. And the sad thing is that if we don't do that in the relatively near future, we may not be able to, I'm afraid. So there is a need to haste on this. But as the director has said, we need to haste with caution and with clear plans and objectives as to what we wanted to achieve. So having seen this possibility, I put together a plan for just a museum of computing and cryptography, which I felt I could fund from the computing industry, or manage to get some of my friends to fund for me. I went along to Property Holdings and BT with this plan, and they really said, just please go away, we don't want to know about you, you're spoiling our plans for selling the park for large amounts of money, there's no way we want a museum in the centre of what's going to be a very expensive development. They didn't take me seriously, and in my career certain other people have not taken me seriously. I then immediately applied through the Conservation Society for planning permission on the park for a museum of computing in the centre and serve notice on BT and Property Holdings. That caused a certain amount of fluttering in the dove cots. I was now taken seriously, and also the exposure of that to the Milton Keynes Borough Council and the Milton Keynes Development Corporation caused them to sit up and take notice, because it's a very sad reflection that the officers of the Milton Keynes Development Corporation, when they drew up a planning brief for Bletchley Park, were not aware of the history and significance of Bletchley Park. They had no idea, they literally had no idea what went on there. So a planning brief for the development of houses and factories and things was drawn up for the park with absolutely no consideration whatsoever to its historical background, and I find that quite amazing. When we took them along to the park and explained to them what went on there and talked to them, then of course they were immediately enthused about this, and why didn't we know about this before, sort of thing. And the result of that is...
That's who you find interesting. Pioneers are...
Finding the tape to start the thing off with it.
I'm just trying to remember which tape
I don't think it matters very much. I'll just use this one.
Okay.
This is the security tape.
Right.
It's the backup. You don't actually use it much, you just use it to get started.
Right. Does that need to go on a particular drive?
No, it has to be labeled zero.
Okay.
This may have to be on write enabled, I'm not sure about that. I don't remember that. These are under tension if they're on local, so you have to actually have it off.
Right.
And on remote. Make sure it's on enough to get it the formatted area. This goes in and goes running up, and then it's 0701, 7300 there.
0701.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. 0701, right.
That's yep. 0701,
yeah.
7300 and up.
Yep, sure.
Yeah. Right, this has got to be in link mode, which it is. So I think this has to be all that way.
Yeah.
The easiest way to do it is to clear everything in France.
Yeah. Right. And then set out that...
Yeah,
well...
0701, 7300.
Yeah.
And then it's... To make sure it's stopped. IO preset, do.
Yeah.
That's right.
Ah, and it's gone, yes.
And then start 20. And that should do it.
Oh, I see.
There it is. So it started now.
Yeah.
You come up in an editor.
Yeah.
Ah, sorry, one called Dial. Use Dial. This is the main manual for the operating system, the one I use anyway.
Right, yeah.
Called Dial. And...
Is that... So this has to be on the tape. It's read from the tape, is it? Or
I think it's basically booted from the tape.
Right.
But then it should work off the disk.
Yeah.
Now I don't think it actually uses the tape anymore at all.
Right.
Unless it wants to use it, of course.
The disk, is it?
It's a directory of that tape, actually.
Yeah.
I think it's DX, comma. The tapes... No, sorry, that was wrong. The tapes can be numbered from 0 to 9, and so the disk is treated as a part... it's partitioned into the equivalent of, I think it's 6 tapes or 7 tapes.
Right.
So they start at 10.
Yep.
So they just have a different... numbering, that's all.
Yeah.
They look just like tapes to the system.
Nice. Oh, I'm hitting the disc, yeah, right.
So, yeah, so I'm looking at what's on the disc at the moment.
Okay, fine, yeah.
I don't know how you get to see more.
So what? This was it.
think this disc has the synthesizer stuff on it.
Okay, don't know this.
Let's have another quick look through.
Trying out the printer again.
No. Trying out the printer, simply refreshed.
Yeah.
So it's an easy way to tell.
Yeah, you lock how the printer goes, yeah.
Whether it's doing something else or not. Some of the, you know, programs I've had, but
yeah.
It's not looking very good at the moment.
Oh, well.
I think I must have had another disc because that was all the discs they got.
Oh, yeah, that was all the discs, yeah.
Right.
Well. Happy synthesis.
Right.
So what did you get? How did you get into that one?
As long as this disc is in,
yeah.
It's number 10.
It's disc number 10.
That's right.
Yeah, okay.
Assuming you're in the normal mode, Yeah. You hit line feed to get into the command mode.
Right.
And it's LO space SP comma 10, which is just what's in the specs manual.
Okay, right, yeah.
So,
yeah.
Now, I think if you hit any key. Oh, it's over here now. I think there's a way I can. It seems to be printing at the terminal. I think. Now, I just have to figure out how to load programs, because then I think we'll really. Load file, I guess. Okay, I have a program in there. Try to go. If it's playing out, should we hear something now?
Oh, maybe even not switched on. Wait a minute.
That little speaker needs switching
yeah.
on. We may have some trouble running this because it depends on some external equipment.
Okay.
So I'm not sure it's how far we're going to get, but I think it's synthesizing the stimuli now. Unfortunately, folk was a language it was nearly impossible to document.
Yeah. We still don't know whether the leads are connected correctly or whether they've got out orders. I don't know whether they said they had got forks out.
They did say that.
Oh, okay, right. So that means something's getting through.
It's trying to do something anyway. set up right.